Good evening. Welcome to Northlake Baptist Church Wednesday night service. And you will see from the very beginning, things are a little different. Good news, Derek does not have COVID. I'll get that in there. See. But he does have strep. And he didn't want to share that with you. So rather than him being up here croaking out the worship song, you have me to croak out a worship song, but I'm going to expect you to sing with me, sing loud, have a stand, if you would, up. And tonight's message, we're just going to contradict that statement almost immediately with this song. This is my Father's world. This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols sing, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass, He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world, the battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. Let us pray. Blessed is your name, O God, Elohim, the God creator. Lord, this is indeed your world, and you turned it over to us, and we've made a mess of it. Lord, we ask you to help us to be good stewards of this world. And yet so many in the world today have forgotten the Creator and are worshiping the creation. Lord, we just ask you to fill us with your knowledge, with your word, that we can go out and correct these wrong-thinking people, help them to see that you are truly the majestic one, the one who deserves our love and our praise. And we ask this in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Emil, for standing in for Derek tonight and for leading us as we begin our Wednesday night service. So good to see you who are here in person, and those who are joining online, welcome as well. If you have your Bibles, please open to Revelation, and if you'll leave them open, we'll go from Revelation to Genesis and then back to Revelation tonight before it's over. So we'll have fun with this. Wanted to share a topic tonight. We're going to talk a little bit about climate change, since that seems to be in the news, because starting this coming Sunday night, October 31st to November the 12th, the United Nations Annual Climate Conference will convene in Glasgow, Scotland. The importance of this conference is stated at the group's website, where it says, climate change is the greatest risk facing us all. Around the world, storms, floods, wildfires are intensifying. Air pollution sadly affects the health of tens of millions of people, and unpredictable weather causes untold damage to homes and livelihoods too. In order to tackle this existential threat to the planet Earth, the United Nations is challenging all the nations of the world to achieve three goals. Number one, achieve net zero, or basically zero pollution, or at least for all the pollution, be able to offset it with something that's non-polluting by 2050, which means we must accelerate the phase out of coal, curtail deforestation, speed up the switch to electric vehicles, and encourage investment in renewable energy. Number two, we need to protect our communities and natural habitats. The climate is already changing, and it will continue to change even as we reduce emissions with devastating effects. The UN encourages countries to protect and restore ecosystems, build defenses, and resilient infrastructure and agriculture to avoid loss of homes, livelihood, and even lives. Number three, mobilize finance. You probably figured that one was coming. To deliver on our first two goals, we got developing countries must make good on their promise to mobilize at least $100 billion in climate finance per year. $100 billion from each developed country per year. And it's said in, on their website, I guess they hadn't updated, but said by 2020. And of course, 2020, I don't think all the countries have paid what they're supposed to pay last year. Anyway, international financial institutions must play their part and work toward unleashing the trillions, with a T, in private and public sector finance required to secure global net zero. And of course, number four is to work together to deliver us from the climate crisis. And of course, the question of the evening was, well, what do you think? Is there a global environmental crisis? 9% of you said yes, 88% said no, and undecided was 4%. Well, I don't know what I'm gonna do with these Northlakers. Y'all are going against the flow, because with us saying 88% no, our national and world leaders are saying yes, that there is a global environmental crisis. Our very own president is offering the UN his full support in an executive order dated January 27th of 2021. He says, it is the policy of my administration that climate considerations shall be an essential element of United States foreign policy and national security. He says, climate change has become a climate crisis. The scientific community has made clear that the scale and speed of necessary action is greater than previously believed. There's little time left to avoid setting the world on a dangerous, potentially catastrophic climate trajectory. That was the president. Next is the United States Secretary of Defense, General Lloyd Austin, said at defense.gov that climate change is an existential threat. Today, no nation can find lasting security without addressing the climate crisis. So that means it's a bigger problem than North Korea or China or Russia or Islamic terrorism. It's the biggest existential threat or threats to our existence that there is. Many of our congressional leaders agree. In an article from thehill.com on January of 2019, Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Democrat from New York, said the world will end in 12 years if climate change is not addressed. 12 years from 2019 would be roughly 2030, so we don't have long for this world. Almost all Democrats agree and are trying to pass President Biden's $3.5 trillion spending bill called Build Back Better, which is loaded with items from the Green New Deal environmental agenda. And then the Pope weighed in. On October the 9th, Pope Francis announced that he will not be able to attend the climate conference, but he spoke about it from the Vatican, and he called on all the world leaders to overcome the narrow confines of partisan politics and quickly reach consensus in fighting climate change. Afterwards, the Pope had a private audience with Nancy Pelosi, who you know as the Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives, who afterwards expressed great gratitude for the immense moral clarity and urgency that this holiness, the Pope, continues to bring to the climate crisis. Now, while the Pope Francis may not be able to attend the conference, another big name politician said he would be able to be there, and that was former President of the United States, Barack Obama. He announced that he will be in Glasgow, and he said this during an online YouTube original event called Dear Earth, where he made the keynote address and encouraged the younger generation to save the Earth from man-made global climate change. So it is obvious that even though we at Northlake may not be in full agreement, that the powers that be in the United States and the United Nations are so convinced that climate change is the greatest problem that we face, so much so that they're willing to spend trillions of dollars and wreck the world economy so that we can save the world from climate change. Is this really what the science is telling us, or is something else going on? One celebrity scientist and medical doctor who disagreed with all this hype was Michael Crichton. You may recognize that name. He is a writer of books and movies. One of those was Jurassic Park. How many of y'all saw that movie? And Andromeda Strain and the TV series ER. In addition to being a celebrity who are not known for being very smart, he is also pretty smart. He did his undergraduate studies at Harvard. He graduated summa cum laude, which I did not when I was in college. He also earned an MD from Harvard Medical School. Well, before he died in 2008 of lymphoma at age 66, Crichton had written a book in 2004 called The State of Fear. It was a cautionary tale about imaginary threats that were started by special interest groups and were fanned by media hype and turned into public policy through political hysteria. Does that sound familiar? So it ended up being a prophetic book, it sounds like to me. Well, anyway, a few years ago, I read a speech that Michael Crichton made to the Commonwealth Club, which was a public affairs forum in California. And he titled his speech, "The Most Important Challenge Facing Mankind is the Challenge of Distinguishing Truth from Propaganda." It was kind of a long article, so I will paraphrase. But basically, he gave the example of environmentalism. First thing he said is he is in full agreement that the future of the human race does depend on us properly taking care of the environment. However, he said environmentalism has become much more than natural science. It has, in fact, become a religion. He said in his studies of anthropology at Harvard, he found that religion is one of those social constructs that mankind cannot eliminate. It seems to be hardwired into humanity. All of us are going to worship something. Something is going to be our God. And we need that in order to find meaning in life. He then goes on to describe what that means in terms of environmentalism. He said, environmentalism is the religion of choice for urban atheists. He said, most religions have a Garden of Eden, a state of innocence. Then there's a fall, followed by judgment and a plan of salvation. He said, environmentalism is no different. He said, they try to sound 100% scientific, but they are as passionate and dogmatic as any fundamentalist of any religion. They believe what they believe is right, and anyone who disagrees with them is wrong and an enemy. He describes Eden. He said, Eden was man in his natural state before civilization, industrialization, and modernization. And of course, you see this narrative in most nature films and environmentalist documentaries. And it goes something like this. Back when indigenous people lived here, the earth was pure and pristine, the air was fresh, the water was clean, life on earth was good. And then come those mean old Christian missionaries with their capitalism, and then came big business and then big oil, and they polluted the good earth, and unless we change our ways, the world as we know it is doomed. Well, what do you do for salvation? Well, they got a salvation here too. You need to repent of your carbon emissions, of your pesticide use, of your consumerism, and return to the innocent natural ways of the Native Americans. Use only sustainable energy, such as solar and wind. Eat only organic foods. Renew, reuse, recycle. Ride bicycles. Become at one with the earth. Crichton then stops and says, we need to get rid of religious environmentalism. He said, it's a strange mixture of science and religion, of faith and facts, and the more religious it gets, the more hysterical and fanatical it gets. Scientific facts get thrown to the wayside by politics. Does this sound like we're going somewhere with this? I mean, to me, he's hitting the nail on the head. Crichton goes on to say, the truth is, back before industrialization, 150 to 200 years ago, the world was not paradise. Mankind was not innocent and good. There never was a noble savage as portrayed by 18th century romantic writers. When the Indians lived, the average lifespan was 40 years. 4 out of 5 children died before they reached the age of 5. 1 out of 6 women died in childbirth. Native Americans lived in a constant state of tribal warfare. Many practiced infanticide and human sacrifice. Hunting and gathering may sound romantic, that is, until you begin to starve. He went on to say that urban atheists may long for simpler days, but most of the people who are in the environmental movement right now have no idea. They normally mean a weekend at the lake or mountain in a cabin with screened porches and electricity. He said, most people crying about the rainforest have never spent a week in the rainforest with bugs and leeches and infection and cooking critters over an open fire. No phone, no light, no motor car, not a single look. No, that's Gilligan's Island there. But anyway, he said, far from being good and hospitable, the natural world is often cruel and unforgiving. There are regular news stories of weekend adventurers freezing to death in an avalanche, of being attacked by bears, drowning in rapids, or falling off of mountains. Matter of fact, we got one this weekend up in the mountains here where he got off the trail somewhere and got lost. It's a tough world out there. But he said, most urbanites have no idea what it would be like to live like the Indians. But compared to the hustle and bustle of their unhappy city lives, they believe it would be good. Therefore, he said, once it becomes a belief, it skews the scientific data. And that's pretty much the end of his article there. So who knows whether there really is an environmental crisis or not? Who knows? Half of what we hear, is it fact or is it faith by atheistic environmentalists? An example of what Crichton is talking about here is America's original high priest of environmental religion, and that is the former nearly president, Nobel Prize winner, Al Gore. He wrote a book, made a movie called An Inconvenient Truth, and he preached that our world is doomed because of global warming. If you ask him, well, what must we do to be saved? He would tell you we need to live a carbon neutral lifestyle. You ladies need to be using a clothesline instead of an electric dryer. You need to be driving a hybrid. You need to use renewable energy. But I always ask the question, well, how does he live? You know, you hear him talk, you would think he lives in a teepee and travels the country on a painted pony. But no, he actually flies around the country in a private jet. At the time he wrote his book, he lived in a 10,000 square foot mansion in Nashville, Tennessee with 20 rooms, 8 bathrooms. And I wonder what kind of carbon footprint was with that. By the way, he has downsized now because he was criticized so bad because of that. Then following Al Gore, we had another environmental crusader president, Barack Obama, and his trusty VP, now President Joe Biden. Barack Obama, in a campaign speech in 2008, said, we cannot afford more of the same timid politics when the future of our planet is at stake. Global warming is not a someday problem, it's now. We're already breaking records with the intensity of our storms, the number of forest fires, the periods of drought. By 2050, famine could force more than 250 million people around the world from their homes. Sea levels are rising. The polar ice caps are now melting faster than the scientists ever predicted. This is not the kind of future I want for my daughters, and it's not the future any of us want for our children. If we act now and we act boldly, that doesn't have to be our future. However, since then, former President Barack Obama has completed the purchase of an $11.75 million waterfront house situated at Martha's Vineyard in Massachusetts. The house is 6,892 square feet. It sits on nearly 30 secluded acres, 7 bedrooms, 8.5 bathrooms, fronting the Edgartown Great Pond with views of the Atlantic Ocean. Are y'all surprised? I thought if you believed that sea levels were going to rise like that, I'd be building me a place in the mountains. I don't know about y'all. But here he's built his house down there at sea level. How in the world is that going to work out for you? I'd be worried about those melting polar ice caps myself. No, what we're watching is another facet of the religions of the world. We saw it among the Pharisees in the New Testament, and that is the hypocrisy of leadership. You've got leaders who believe that the rules are for thee, but they're not for me. And that's what Jesus said about them in Matthew 23. He said, they strap heavy burdens on the shoulders of people, but they won't lift one finger in order to be a part of the solution themselves. We've seen it throughout the COVID pandemic. You know, we're supposed to be sheltering in place and wearing masks and practicing 6-foot distancing and all this, but when the cameras go behind the scenes, we see our elite leaders at the top, they're not practicing what they preach. They're living ordinary lives, and they're making us jump through fiery hoops because of something called COVID. Now, from what I've read, I don't believe that Michael Crichton was a Christian, but I believe he was correct with his statement that environmentalism has become a religion. It has become the new world religion. Now, hopefully you find Revelation chapter 13. Revelation 13 tells us in the last days there will be one global government which will be ruled by one global beast who will ultimately be named the Antichrist. Globalism is a political vehicle that is currently being driven to take us to that reality of a one world government, a one world military, a one world economy. In order to put this all together, there will be a need for a one world religion. And we actually see that in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 11. Then I saw another beast. It's already in the first part, it's already introduced the first beast, who is the Antichrist. Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke like a dragon. I wonder who the dragon is. And he exercised all the authority of the first beast in his presence, and he caused the earth and those who dwell in the earth to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. He performed great signs so that he makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. He deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. He is granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. That one world religion that we're talking about will not be Christianity, because in Christianity, the essence of Christianity is the kingdom of heaven, and the king of the kingdom of heaven is the Lord Jesus Christ. And obviously the Antichrist does not want that to happen. There are so many religions in the world, but there's so many diverse beliefs that no particular one is going to be able to unify the whole world. These globalists are humanists. They really don't believe in any kind of religion themselves, but they understand what Michael Crichton was talking about when he said religion is one social structure that mankind can't seem to eliminate. Seems to be hardwired into humanity, a need to find meaning in life. So these globalists have designed their own religion, environmentalism. We must save the planet in order to save the human race. And see, that's something that everybody on earth can wrap their arms around. Nobody wants to see the planet blow up. Nobody wants us all to die. So we embrace this environmentalism business. But even that is idolatry. As Paul teaches us in Romans 1:25, it's idolatry to exchange the truth of God into a lie and to worship and serve created things rather than the Creator. And of course, environmentalism is only an interim step. How many of you know that when the Antichrist appears, that he will be the one that wants to be worshiped? So really, environmentalism is just a step to get us there. And of course, when he appears, then he'll require everybody on earth to worship. But until we get there, the plan is for us to worship the earth. So saving the planet is the propaganda that everything points to right now. Even this global pandemic, I don't know if you remember this from the 419 message, it kind of got some fanfare, but Bill Gates, during a TED Talk interview, he said, once the people of the world learn to trust science to solve the pandemic, maybe they will learn to trust the science to solve climate change. See, folks, it's all about climate change. It's all about the environment. Even COVID that's spread all the way around the world now, it still has a goal, and that is to get us all prepared to accept worshiping the earth, climate change. It's all about climate change. It's all about the environment. Well, while we're talking about that, what is the biblical truth about environmentalism? Well, for that, let's go back to Genesis in the very beginning. And we'll find out that the Lord does want us to take care of this environment that He's blessed us with. From earliest chapters of Genesis, we're called to be good stewards, good managers of God's creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15, then the Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to do what? To exploit it, to pollute it, no, to tend and to keep it. So we have a responsibility to take care of the earth. Now turn to Deuteronomy, and it gets more specific. Deuteronomy chapter 20, where it talks to us about protecting the forests. It said, even during tough times, during desperate times, like when you're at war, you shall not destroy the trees by wielding it an axe against them. If you can eat of them, do not cut them down to use for a siege, for the tree of the field is man's food. Also, Deuteronomy 22, verse 6. If you happen to notice a bird's nest along the road, whether in a tree or on the ground, and there are chicks on the or eggs with the mother bird sitting on them, you will not take the mother from the young. So again, you got Christians are called to manage God's creation, both the flora and the fauna. We're supposed to handle it wisely. We're all supposed to be conservationists. We're all supposed to save stock for next year, whether we're talking about plants or whether we're talking about animals. So yeah, that's part of the management that we're called to do. So I'm not against conservation. I'm not against taking care of the environment. The problem, the big lie behind environmentalism is it goes like this. If the people of the world will only cooperate and fix our environment and remove pesticides and carcinogens and greenhouse gases, then we can live forever. We are the captain of our fate. We are the master of our souls, and that is wrong. The truth is, we're all going to die, and we're going to live until we die, and then we will spend eternity somewhere. For most of us, our average lifespan is going to be 70 to 80 years. That comes from Psalms chapter 90 and verse 10. The day of our lives are what, 70? 70. The days of our lives are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80 years, yet their boast is only labor, and you spend all your time going to the doctor's office, it'll soon be cut off. Well, I added that. And then we fly away. And then Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27 tells us about our flying away. It is appointed to man, what, once to die, and after that, the judgment. So in the middle of this short life that you and I have, we can make our earthly journey easy or difficult, based on our obedience or disobedience toward our Creator. In Leviticus, why don't you turn to Leviticus back? I know everybody loves to read Leviticus in your daily Bible readings. Leviticus chapter 18. In Leviticus chapter 18, 19, and 20, we see a long list of sins from idolatry to sexual immorality. And the Lord explains that our sins and our disobedience toward the laws of God is what causes an environmental crisis. Listen to what He says in chapter 18, verse 24. Do not defile yourselves with any of these things that these Canaanites are currently living with. For all these things the nations are defiled, which I am casting out before you. The land is defiled. Therefore I visit the punishment of its iniquity upon it, and the land vomits out its inhabitants. You shall therefore keep my statutes, my judgments. You shall not commit any of these abominations, either any of your own nation or any stranger who dwells among you. For all these abominations the men of the land have done who were before you, and thus the land is defiled, lest the land vomit you out, also when you defile it, as it vomited out the nations that were before you. The Lord keeps using that word vomit. Do you think He's trying to make a point? So if you wonder why bad things happen to people on the land, you'll find out. Whoever commits any of these abominations, the persons who commits them shall be cut off from among the people. Therefore you shall keep my ordinance, so that you may not commit any of these abominable customs which were committed before you, and that you do not defile yourselves by them, for I am the Lord your God. According to Leviticus, it is not our failure to renew, reuse, recycle that causes God to vomit people off the land. It's our sins, it's our immorality, it's our idolatry against our Creator that causes the land to reject us. There's where the environmental crisis is. It's not because renew, reuse, recycle, it's because of our sins. The sins in America, the sins around the world. According to Revelation chapter 8, it's going to cause global warming. Did y'all know that? Turn to Revelation chapter 8 now. I told you we'd go back. We've covered the whole Bible tonight. Revelation chapter 8 tells us that because the land has been defiled and it's fixing to vomit us off of the land, that it's going to get extremely hot around here. It's going to get hot in a way, I guess you might could say that global warming is true, but the cause of this global warming is not our carbon emissions or our greenhouse gases. The cause is sin, sins of omission, sins of commission, sins of things that we did, sins of the good things that we should have done that we did not do. Look at Revelation chapter 8 and verse 7. And the first angel blew the first trumpet, there again the trumpet judgments, and there was hail and fire mixed with blood, and it was thrown at the earth, so the third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. And just think, it's only chapter 8. That's only the beginning of the global warming that's going to come on God's judgment day. So Danny, what can we do? How can we fix this global warming? How can we fix this environmental crisis? Well, the short answer is you can't. Again, it's the hypocrisy of mega corporations that is so frustrating. We're told in various forms on our media that we are guilty of filling up our landfill with plastics. Oh, and it's just awful out there. But that kind of begs the question, who fills our stores shelves with all the plastics that ends up in the landfill? Well, it's the same mega corporations that are paying the public service announcements to put us on a guilt trip. It's amazing to me, I read a story a while back about a guy named John Sylvan who invented the Keurig. How many of y'all, I'm not gonna ask how many of y'all do Keurig. Well, now he's all upset about it because he invented the thing, no doubt probably made a little money off of it, and now he's coming out against it that it's not environmentally friendly. Well, who put it on our shelves? You put these products, we have no choice but to buy them because what else are you going to do? If you know, we got to live. And so these manufacturers put this stuff on it, and then they turn around and try to put us on a guilt trip because we use them and we use stuff that they make that's disposable, so it ends up in the landfill. But it's your fault. How many of you feel guilty about that? You need to. You ought to feel guilty about this. I couldn't help but think while I was going through this, I got on a roll, I just couldn't help myself. You know, our grandmothers 100 years ago who used glass jars to store their food and recycle things for next year were more earth-friendly than the mega corporations today. Amen. Our grandfather's generation used to build products that would last a long time, and if those products quit working, guess what? They could be taken to a shop and repaired. But now our mega corporations build products with programmed obsolescence that are designed to be disposable, so we're forced to get rid of those problems every couple of years because they're worn out. And where do they end up? In the landfill. And whose fault is it? Yours. I mean, that's the way this thing works. We sell it to you, it doesn't last long, it goes to the landfill, and then it's your fault. So you get guilt because you're buying it, and you get guilt because you throw it away. Is this a wonderful country or what? We're told to quit using fossil fuel, quit using all that gas out there. Well, who keeps manufacturing all these gas-guzzling vehicles? Not me. How many of y'all made a car this past week? I have another question. How many of you remember the 1970s when price of gas went way up and they started manufacturing all those little cars? You had little cars, little trucks with four-cylinder engines and all that kind of stuff. You'd think if they really thought this was a big deal that they'd be made. How many of you tried to buy one of those small cars or small trucks lately? You can't. They're building big honking F-150s and all this kind of stuff now. Why is that? If these guys were serious about fixing a problem, why don't we have smaller vehicles with smaller engines and all this? I don't know. Maybe it's just me. And while I'm on a roll, electric vehicles. Boy, we need to get those electric vehicles rolling. Let me tell you something. I'm 65 years old. When I was in high school, somebody calculate when that was, back in the 70s, how many of you know that they were building electric cars at Georgia Tech? Matter of fact, they drove one from Georgia Tech all the way to North Gwinnett High School and let us drive it around the parking lot in our engineering class. And I asked them, when will these things be available? I'd love to have one of those. They said, you'll never have one. And I said, why? They said, because as soon as we develop it, either one of the big automakers or one of the big oil companies buys it off the line. As soon as it goes out, they buy the patent, and then you never see it again. Now, somebody tell me who's serious about this environmental problem that we got going on here. A few years ago, I read an article about how much, and this was designed to make everybody feel guilty, I read an article about how much environmental damage is done in the production of a t-shirt. They started on the farm, on the cotton field, and how those chemicals were awful and destroying the environment, all that kind of stuff, and then we pick the cotton and we take it to the mill, and all kinds of water has to be involved in processing this cotton and turning it into cloth, cleaning it and dyeing it and printing it and all that. And it was just awful. It's a disaster how many billions of gallons of water we're messing up that way. And then we have to ship those t-shirts to Walmart and from there to our homes and all that kind of stuff. And how much gas is burned, how many gallons of diesel fuel in order to get your t-shirt to the store so that you can buy it. And it was just awful. And as a matter of fact, they turned it into a cartoon that they're showing at schools around. It's how environmentally friendly that something as simple as a t-shirt can be. But you know what was amazing to me is every time I look at an environmental protest on TV, they're wearing new t-shirts. They at least wear an old t-shirt. Why do you have to make a new t-shirt and pollute the environment? Another thing that really wears me out is, like for me, I was preparing for this message here. I was looking for some good articles about environmentalism. And you know what? You find your nice little one-page article and you say, that's neat. They kind of pull that thing together. I think I'll print it out. Has anybody tried to print anything out off the internet lately? You want one page? How many you get?
Three.
7 pages of worthless advertising that goes for it. How many of you? You know what I'm talking about. I wonder if these computer programmers realize that for every ton of paper, that's 24 trees that bit the dust. Are they thinking about that? No, they don't think about that. They just make me feel guilty about that because here I am printed that thing out when I should just left it online, I guess. Not only is environmentalism a religion, it's also a racket. And let me give you an example. Big oil is okay with environmental hype. Why would they do that? Is it logical that big oil would be financing the environmental movement? I think the reason they do that is because they know that wind and solar are not viable energy alternatives. All this global climate change hysteria, all it does is ensure that oil companies will be in business for a longer time. Every little bit that they offset, it just means that less oil to burn today, but it'll still be out there that needs to be burned tomorrow, and they'll still be in charge of it, and they're making money on both sides. They're making money, they're investing in these companies that are going green, but they're also still holding their assets in oil, knowing that these green companies ain't gonna make it over time, but they'll still have plenty of oil to sell you as we go forward into the future. Oil companies are investing in green energy all the time. All you gotta do is look at their TV commercials and see how big they are into the green. Oil companies even sponsor environmental groups. How many of you knew that? Would it shock you to know how many of you ever heard of Greenpeace? You know, they're always out there protesting, we need to save Mother Earth and all this kind of stuff. Greenpeace is sponsored by the Rockefeller Foundation. Now, somebody tell me, does Rockefeller have any connection to oil whatsoever? I mean, the whole oil industry started with J.D. Rockefeller. So, you know, it's just amazing when you start putting all that together. Also, you may have heard that we're fixing to get into cap and trade and carbon tax schemes where if you've got to pollute, then you've got to pay so much to the government to atone for your sins of polluting and all this kind of stuff. So the long and short of that, it's going to end up being a very expensive, very lucrative proposition. So, but what happens there is only big oil companies are going to be able to compete. Small to mid-sized companies won't be able to pay all these fees in order to do their business, so they'll go out of business. And so What happens there is it's called a monopoly, which are supposed to have antitrust laws to keep monopolies from happening. But lo and behold, the bigger companies are getting bigger. But as John D. Rockefeller said many years ago, competition is sin. And John D. Rockefeller didn't believe in sin, nor did he believe in competition. So you got to get rid of the competition. I call it kicking the ladder. What's happening in the world today is kicking the ladder. These huge corporations have worked long and hard to get to the top of the world. So now they take their profits and hire their lobbyists to make environmental laws and regulations so difficult, so onerous, that small companies can never compete. And so what that does is they've made it to the top, now they kick the ladder down so that nobody can come up behind them and compete against them. And that's the state of environmentalism today. Bottom line, what's Danny saying here? I need to wrap it up, don't I? Bottom line, there's very little that the average person can do to fix the environment. Only thing you can do is run to the Lord God, your Creator, and put your faith and trust in Him and His Son, Jesus Christ, for He alone can fix things. He alone can save you. Yes, we should be good conservationists of the earth that God has given us, and no, we should not waste or pollute the resources that God has provided for us. But brothers and sisters, as Christians, we should not live in fear of every new trick that these global elites cook up to move us toward their new world order, because our goal is not a new world order. Our goal is the kingdom of heaven. Amen? Amen. And that's what we need to stay focused on and remember that. That's what Jesus tried to tell us in Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Jesus said, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom of heaven." That's what He's trying to do in and through us. John 14:1, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions." The kingdom of heaven, that's what our goal is, not trying to come up with some kind of fiefdom on earth or some kind of new world order. Also, one of my favorite passages, when it comes time to go to bed and you've listened to this crazy stuff on TV or on the internet or whatever, on the radio all day long, Psalm 46. "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear." We will not fear, even though the earth may be removed. We will not fear, though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. We will not fear, though climate rises 1 degree Celsius over 100. No, I added that one. The Lord says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." After all, as we sung in the beginning, this is my Father's world, and I rest me in that thought. And by the way, folks, what I've tried to share tonight with you is the truth. And that's my worldview, and that's how I process the news as I hear it on a daily basis. And that's also how I sleep peacefully at night, even after hearing the breaking news that's coming over the airways. I will not fear. Why? Because the Lord my God, He is there. He is my refuge and my strength. And let's go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you, Father, that you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Lord, help us not to be fearful, but faithful. Help us to be faithful stewards of the earth that you have given us. Help us to be faithful managers of the life that you have given us. Help us to be faithful ministers of the gospel that you have given us. Help us not to be fearful, but faithful. Till you come, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.